All right. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining. I'm just watching the little attendee panel on my screen here and seeing so many familiar names. So I wish we could see your faces as well, but we are just thrilled to know that you are here with us today, and really looking forward to a wonderful session together. So as you all know, today is our latest installment of our Meeting of the Minds webinar series. And as we get started, I would love for you to take a moment to introduce yourself in the chat, so your name and institution, along with your role there. And if you'd like, maybe also tell us what brought you to this session today. Today's Meeting of the Minds session is an opportunity for us to engage in a rich discussion about the role of AI in broadening participation in computing efforts. We have a stellar panel joining us, and our moderator is a champion of this work and longtime friend of NCWIT's, Dr. Enrico Pontelli. Dr. Pontelli currently serves as the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences at New Mexico State University. He's been involved in a broad range of efforts of BPC efforts, including the creation of New Mexico State's Young Women in Computing program, which has actually been in place since 2006 and has served thousands of students in southern New Mexico. He also serves on the leadership team of CASI, which you may have heard from last month if you joined us for our last Meeting of the Mind session. And he's actually the CASI Southwest Region lead. His institution is also participating in our current cohort of the Learning Circles program, which is one of NCWIT's key initiatives focused on systemic change. So, Enrico, thank you so much for being here today, along with this fantastic panel. And before I turn it over to you, let me just mention that my colleague Jamie Huber Ward will be monitoring the chat for questions. So, if you have questions for the panelists, feel free to put that in the chat or use the Q&A module that we also have in the Zoom room. And as we get closer to wrapping up, my colleague Nancy will be sharing an evaluation link. So please do take the time to fill that out. I know if you're anything like me, you're just like, oh, it's just another form to fill out. But those responses really do matter to us. We really do look at them. So please do take the time to fill that out for us. So thank you so much, Enrico. I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Saraya. Thank you so much. And let me start my sharing my screen so that we can have actually something to look at. I hope everybody is going to be able to see. So thank you very much to NCWIT for allowing us to have this conversation. And as Saraya was mentioning, I'm actually going to be joined by an amazing group of people. So really, we should pay attention to what they say, not to what I say. But let me actually take a moment just to do a quick introduction about this session. So first of all, let's try to see if we can motivate why we're having this session today. Of course, everybody are talking about AI these days. And of course, if we want to actually define what is AI, if we ask 20 researchers to tell you what AI is, you're probably going to get 20 different answers. I really like this definition that I pulled from a document from the European Commission, and I just highlighted the keywords, which are really the ones that, in my mind, define what AI is. AI is software systems, and software system that defines that ex shows some type of behavior that we would consider as intelligent, capable of making some type of autonomous decisions in order to solve specific goals. And of course, AI can be either part of another software system, like a voice assistant, or be embedded in some hardware device, like, for example, a self-driving vehicle. I really love this quote from Kate Crawford because it really kind of captures what is the spirit of this session. Like all technologies, artificial intelligence will reflect the values of its creators, which means that whatever is the belief systems, the value system, the stereotypes of who defines and designs artificial intelligence, the same behaviors and the same habits and biases are going to be reflected by AI. And that's something that we really need to keep in mind then, as we go through this session. So now AI is not all bad. There is a lot of good and there is a lot of potential. So let's actually start from a positive perspective. AI has a lot of potential to benefit broadening participation. We have seen a lot of examples of AI-driven decision systems that have been used to actually remove human biases and human inconsistencies, for example, in the context of job interviews or university admissions decisions. AI can be used to detect biases, like, for example, analyzing language and try to detect that language may be biased. Or, for example, helping us basing our decision on actual data to provide fair promotion, fair salary increases. Machine learning optimization systems are very good in dealing with many features, which could actually help us when we want to do a very fine-grained analysis or doing some type of intersectionality analysis. So there is a lot of good, a lot of potential there. And if we move our conversation to the context of education, there is even more potential. AI could be the instrument that is going to take us closer to the dream of personalized education, where we can have super teaching assistants that provide personalized feedback and rapid feedback to the individual student, help learning. For example, generative AI is great if you want to teach students how to ask the right questions and or to assist students who are language learners to actually refine their language skills. If then we talk about students with special needs, the benefit can be even greater. We have seen example of generative AI used to provide social scripts for students on the spectrum, or for example, to provide continuous prompts to students with ADHD, or using AI to create smart assistants for people with visual or hearing impairments. So there is a lot of good that can come up with AI. At the same time, we know that there are also the bad sides and the dangers, and we have seen that in many, many instances. AI models are typically prepared and trained using materials that come from the internet. And as such, they will reflect the biases of the material that is used to train these models. Even popular algorithms that are used for mapping words to vectors, which are essential in order to do language analysis, they've shown to demonstrate gender biases. And you know, we know that bias is already present on the internet and on all this corpus that is used to train machine learning. The risk of AI is that these biases are amplified. So we do really have a problem of scale. And as we use machine learning to translate data into knowledge, that danger is going to become even more evident. I go back to the quote from Kate Crawford that I mentioned earlier on. The majority of developers of AI are still overwhelmingly belonging to privileged groups. Only 26% of the AI workforce is currently women, which obviously leads us to the danger of biases. And we've seen in the literature a lot of examples of these biases. Facial recognition failures are much larger for dark-skinned women, 34% higher. Large language models that are used to train machine learning systems are based on corpuses that are heavily biased from the gender point of view. We talk about family men, we don't talk about family women. We talk about judge, but then when we talk about woman, we talk about a woman judge. Men are very often described in terms of their capabilities, and women are instead described in terms of appearance. And we've seen examples where the result is a very superficial view of gender, gender seen as a binary factor, or systems that are unable to distinguish between sex, gender, and sexuality. And when we talk about underserved communities, that becomes even more serious because not only we have biases, but we also have data sets that are not representative because we have challenges in collecting data from certain underserved communities. We don't have weather stations in rural areas. We don't have the same ability to collect and manage electronic health records from underserved communities. And only 0.2% of mapped genomes come from groups that represent over 20% of the world population. And these, of course, results in biased systems. And we have a lot of examples, like for example, the COMPASS system, which is a system used to assist courts in assessing the likelihood of a defendant being a repeating crime offender, which have been shown to be heavily biased in terms of race. Or for example, the failure by the Rite Aid shops to use facial recognition to flag potential shoplifter, which again showed heavily discriminatory behavior. And when we move to the context of education, that danger is actually even more nuanced. For example, we see a lot of fear about the use by students of generative AI as a cheating instrument, which is leading us to shift in testing models, a lot of more in-class exams, more oral exams, without realizing that this is going to have a potential dangerous impact on students who suffer of text anxiety, or for example, students who are language learners. Or the fact that we are using AI to detect the use of AI, which may flag as plagiarism students with disability who are using AI as an assistive tool. So if there is a message that I hope we're going to take away from today's session is that the beneficial and ethical use of AI will have to start from teaching how to effectively and ethically use AI. So allow me to introduce my friend and colleague, Irene Lee, who is going to talk about starting early in the use of AI. Irene? Uh, Irene, I don't think we can hear you.
Yeah, Irene, you're muted.
My apologies. I'll start over.
Yeah, go ahead.
thank you very much, Enrico. My name's Irene Lee. I'm a research scientist at MIT and EDC. And I'm the PI of two NSF-funded projects that focused on AI literacy. One was called Developing AI Literacy, or DAILY, and the other one is Everyday AI. So now that we have a sense of the benefits and challenges of AI from Enrico, I'm going to talk a little bit about approaches being studied in AI education for K-12 to ensure a wide range of students learn about AI and are interested in studying AI or AI within other disciplines as they reach high school and beyond. So why start early? Here are some of the common arguments. One is that AI is everywhere, even in children's toys, and thus will be part of children's experiences. Another is that children need to be aware of when AI is being used and perhaps trained to not give away any personally identifying information. Children need to be empowered to understand, use, and evaluate AI. And we hope that children will become AI literate citizens. Finally, early exposure and explorations of AI may also impact future participation of underrepresented groups in AI. Next. So in the two projects mentioned, we define AI literacy as at the K-12 level as the subset of AI knowledge and competencies relevant to becoming an informed citizen and critical consumer of AI. And thus, we say it encompasses understanding technical concepts in AI, ethics related to AI, and impact of AI on futures and careers. We believe that this AI learning at middle school is possible because our learning goals for technical concepts are conceptual and not deeply mathematical at this age range. Also, there is prior research that shows that even young children have the capacity for ethical thinking, and middle school students have developed a sense of morality and consciousness, conscience based on their values. Next slide. So this is an overview of the DAILY, or Developing AI Literacy, curriculum that was developed at MIT. It's a 30-hour curriculum aiming to develop AI literacy in middle and early high school age students. The design of the curriculum was based on our definition. We're aiming to help students become informed citizens and critical consumers of AI. So this curriculum interweaves ethics in AI, core AI concepts, including ones having to do with creativity with generative AI, and AI careers and futures. Next slide. I'm going to give you a few examples of how we paired AI concepts with ethical concerns. So in this module, we introduce AI through a age-appropriate definition. We ask students to learn for, or ask, is it using a data set? Is there possibly a learning algorithm at work? And is this tool making a prediction? And using that description, they sort various tools and things from their real life, like toasters and elevators, into either AI or not AI. And then we pair that with an activity where we ask students to develop an algorithm for the best peanut butter and jelly sandwich. And doing that, students have different opinions of what makes it best. And we have students fill out this matrix shown in green about the different stakeholders that they're taking into account of who are the stakeholders of that sandwich and what are their values. So you'll see a child might be interested in taste, whereas a parent is also interested in nutrition and cost, and a doctor might be interested in nutrition. And then they look at their sandwich again and say, okay, whose values am I addressing and whose values am I leaving out? So they become more critical, and it attaches to their ethical ideas and imaginations. Next slide. Then in the second module, we have students learn about human-inspired decision-making through decision trees in which they develop the features to put in different nodes such that it'll sort pasta into unique categorizations. They also make a decision tree to sort clothing into whether it's for winter or not for winter. And we talk about how decision trees are used in real life. That is complemented with activities to recognize ethical issues and encourage students to take ethics seriously. So there are a series of case studies, like the picture at the bottom, where they've shown an image here of a man who is trying to apply for a job, and the system is rejecting his application because it says they need a photograph of him with his eyes open, and he happens to be an Asian man with smaller eyes, so it is not letting him participate. With that type of case study, they go now and look at their own decision trees and look at the features that they've included at different nodes in the decision tree and to see if any bias has seeped into their decision tree or think of things they might not be taking into account. Next slide. And then this example is from module 3 on supervised learning. Students use Google's teachable machine to train their own image classifier, and a common data set is used of dogs and cats. So they train their model, then they test it. Then we complement that with activities in which they used unbalanced or sparse data sets to train the same model and or to train a model using the same tool, and then compare the different outcomes given different training sets. Further, they can generalize this to other examples. Next slide. Okay, and then I'm going to tell you just a little bit about our Everyday AI professional development program. It's 54 hours, and it prepares teachers, either middle or high school teachers, to teach from the daily curriculum. The first 2 years, we worked with teachers in Chicago, Richmond, Virginia, New York City, and Broward County, Florida. And most recently, we've scaled the project to New Mexico. So it has three components. It has a AI book club, and then it has a practicum experience teaching summer camps where teachers practice lessons from the daily curriculum. And finally, there's integration during the academic year. Next slide. Okay, and then I wanted to share some findings. In particular, through our research implementing the daily curriculum with teens and tweens, we found that there was high engagement of all students and an increase of their awareness of AI ethics after experiencing the curriculum. In particular, female students of color were particularly engaged. In our exit interviews, one female student told us of her takeaway, and this is the quote: "My takeaway from the investigating bias activity is that AIs like Google and facial recognition, you can clearly see the bias in that. And even though we think that their things are very, very smart, but I never considered that they might have been really biased until going over these things." Furthermore, students were able to articulate a plan for minimizing bias of AI tools designed after the daily curriculum. So overall, we conclude that integrating ethics throughout the teaching and learning of AI technical concepts is engaging and fruitful for learners. But we also, so it might have implications for broadening participation. It might be a hook, but at the same time, we need to be careful. We don't want to force students of color into a role of having to fix something that they didn't design, right? Or responsible for fixing something that's broken by other people. With that, I'm going to pass to Tom. Thank you very much.
Hi, everyone. My name is Tom Pearson. I'm the Associate Dean of Workforce Programs at Chandler-Gilbert Community College. And I was part of the core team that collaborated with Intel to create the first AI associate degree in AI in the nation. So this is just kind of showing you that even Intel, you know, they realized that we really need to start earlier. So with the community college, there's a lot of things we could do. We could bridge that gap before those move on to a four-year university or even graduate school. So next slide. So our mission at the community college level for artificial intelligence and machine learning, that's our program, we call it AIM, is to provide students with the opportunity to learn about the subject as a beginner while focusing on industry marketability or further study within 2 years. So the bottom line with starting at the community college level to get into our AI program, there are no prerequisites. The students just come in and we're going to teach them from the very start. Next slide. And here's how we started. So in 2019, AI approached Maricopa Community Colleges. Chandler-Gilbert is part of that. And they had their AI for Youth program. And they said, hey, would they want to implement that at the college level? Now, Intel could have went anywhere in the nation, but they chose Maricopa Community College District because they wanted to get this implemented as fast as possible. And they thought that we could do that. And so we took their AI for Youth program. We went through their training. They gave us all the curriculum. It started out in Singapore. It's in Asia here again. It was for high school students. We took that content. We went ahead and modified it to make it college level. And in 2020, we then had the very first AI Associate of Science in the United States. Now, what was really amazing with this is all that collaboration with Intel and we actually, from the start of it, going through their training, receiving their curriculum, developing all the content, well, not all the content, but developing all the competencies for all the classes, it took 6 months from the start of it until we had an associate's degree. In 2022, we had 50 students enrolled. And there's also industry heard that we had this associate's degree. So they approach us. There's a company called EMD. EMD Electronics, they are basically provide equipment to semiconductor manufacturers. And they heard about our training and they asked if we could go ahead and create a non-credit training course customized just for them. So we did that. We created this 40 hours worth of training. We taught them 4 hours a day on Saturdays. And at the end of that, they realized the benefit. They didn't realize they knew AI was important, but they didn't know how they could use it within their company. So we used their actual data from their company in this training. At the end of it, they went ahead and created two new positions just in AI. So that's just showing you the value of AI, how they actually recognized the value of AI. And a lot of companies here, again, they don't know it. And so that's a great place at the community college level to let individuals know, companies, students, and industry, the importance of AI and the importance of knowing AI. Okay. In 2024, we have over 150 students enrolled, and we have now been approved to create a bachelor's degree in AI. So in Arizona, there are no bachelor's degree. All there was graduate level. So we started with associate's degree. We've now been approved to go and create a bachelor's degree. And then students can then do the bachelor's degree in AI and then move on to the graduate level. Next slide. So one thing we're really proud of too is in October of 2023, we held at Chandler-Gilbert Community College an Artificial Intelligence Teaching and Learning Summit. And the whole idea behind the summit was two tracks. One for advocates, how they could go ahead and help advocate for an AI program at their institutions. And one was for faculty that want to teach AI. And in this summit, we had over, well, let me see. In this summit, we had institutions from 26 different states. That was what I'm trying to get out there. So 26 different states attended this. So it was very well attended. We had a lot of people, a lot of great feedback saying how they really enjoyed the summit. So we plan on doing this in the future. Okay, next slide. And this is our offerings for our AI specific courses. So we have AIM 100, which is an introduction to AI. We have a class just on introduction to machine learning, one on introduction to natural language processing, one on introduction to computer vision, one on AI for business, and then an AI capstone project. And with that AI capstone project, we actually reach out to businesses and say, hey, do you have a problem you're trying to solve with AI? Bring it to us. We'll let our students work on that. So they're working on real problems there. Okay, next slide. And this is showing the overall curriculum. This is everything. I'm not going to go through it too much, but it shows all the classes that are required for it. Those in red boxes, we also have what we call a certificate of completion, so they could get just AI-specific content. And prior to that, they do need to have some Python programming, so that's one of the classes that's required. And then they could just take those classes in the red box and get a certificate of completion. And we actually had a lot of, we've had people that already have master's degree that attended our classes just to get the AI competencies there. Okay, next slide. So this is one of our students' capstone projects. So they have a grandmother that takes a lot of pills, put a lot of pills in pill boxes, and then accidentally knock it down, all the pills fall out. So can't see very well. How can she find out what the pill is? So in this capstone project, they went ahead and created an AI model that would then, using computer vision, take a look at the pill, take a picture of the pill, look at the shape of it, look at the color or colors of it. It also look if there's any markings on there. In this case, there's numbers. That is an image. Then they have to translate that image into text and then goes through a database to go ahead and find out what type of pill this is. And you can see it says the medicine name. It also tells that it's 250 milligrams. So this is just trying to help out here again, those that, due to their age or disabilities or whatever, they really just can't determine what the pill was. And it makes it a lot safer for her too, if she can figure out what it is and put it in the appropriate data take. Okay. So that was really a really neat capstone project that one of our students did. Okay. Next. So on this one, I'm going to play a video. This right here was one of our students. They entered a national competition sponsored by Intel, and they won in a certain category. And go ahead and play this, Enrico.
We all exist in an online ecosystem, one where millions of people across the globe consume an average of 1 billion hours of content every day. And this has become the way of life for many. The average person spends 7 hours a day online. We get a notification, we check it. New content's uploaded, we watch it. But do we take the time to audit what type of content is being fed to us? Emotionally charged content is being disguised as personalized recommendations, directing a user's focus from an inquisitive standpoint to an emotional one, without them knowing. The connection between the decline in mental health across the globe and the incline of societal tensions both seem to be spurred on by this emotionally manipulative online rhetoric. A change in the structure of social media recommendation algorithms is a necessity. The goal of our project is to return the control of the content recommendations back to the users, and separately show them what is being fed to them without them knowing. Our code works by installing transformers from Hugging Face to help with the audio-to-text transcription. These transformers are then imported into CoLab via a pipeline. The YouTube video that we choose is then run through an API in order to get the text of the audio transcription. From here, we then create another pipeline to summarize the videos in text form. The summaries then run through a sentiment analysis model, which does a few things. The model will analyze the emotions seen in the text summarization from the video, looking for specific emotions while flagging hateful or aggressive language used in the video. At Intel, manufacturing safety is already a number one priority, but we are striving to improve measures around monitoring the mental well-being of employees. While our model is still in its infancy, we are aiming to expand beyond just the video analysis, which we know has been explored before. The next steps for our model would be to give users a nicely bundled overview of the types of content they consume. This visualization could show the most common tags for the content they consume, total watch time, and of course how potentially emotionally charged the content is. The model could be used to redirect users to more neutral or positive spaces, thus improving a user's mental health and worldview. Looking at what Intel vPro offers, our model could combine digital security beyond cybersecurity and includes personalized psychology. We hope that our program is the start of an algorithmic overhaul where users are in a better state of mind when exploring the web.
So yeah, really proud of our students there. You can see just some of the things you could do with AI. And I'd like to go ahead and pass it on now to Melanie Moses.
Great. Thank you, Tom. I love that video.
We all
I will go ahead and start by introducing you to the work we've done at UNM, kind of from the other end of the academic hierarchy. We actually started at UNM by training, on the next slide, you can see these folks, a group of faculty from across disciplines. So this is our team that we came up with this terrible name, actually. I think it's not a good algorithm or doesn't roll off the tongue, but this is the UNM Santa Fe Institute Interdisciplinary Working Group on Algorithmic Justice. And we formed this group based on some things that happened back in 2016. There was a ProPublica article with a title, "Bias in Criminal Risk Scores is Mathematically Inevitable, Researchers Say." So it's not exactly what the researchers said, but it certainly pointed to a burgeoning problem in using algorithms in criminal justice. And at the same time, New Mexico, that same year, passed a constitutional amendment banning cash bail, with the idea that money shouldn't be the determinant of who pays or, you know, who has the ability to go free before their trial. And so this group, we convened ourselves. So these are computer scientists, lawyers, political scientists, and psychologists who really wanted to investigate questions of how do we understand justice? How can justice be algorithmically implemented in any sense? So on the next slide, I'll highlight a couple of my colleagues, Kathy Powers and Sonia Gibson Rankin, and I, all at UNM, have really sort of a bit of a spin-off group to focus on questions surrounding racial equity in artificial intelligence, particularly. So the next slide highlights some of the things that we've done. And we've done this both to engage stakeholders in the community and to educate ourselves and to learn different perspectives on what justice means in technology. And so some of the activities that we were involved in were have been consulting ever since really 2017. How can risk assessment tools amplify bias? How do you know that tools are trained well if they're used in the criminal justice system to actually reflect the population that is being studied? Do we see fair outcomes across populations or not? And the answer is sometimes we do and sometimes we don't. And it's quite surprising when we look at the data. We moved into talking into some public comments on legislation or proposed policy changes that the Department of Justice proposed that would have required that to have a finding of disparate impact in housing discrimination, illegal lending or landlord decisions about who can become a tenant. One would have to point to a line of code in an algorithm in order to show where the discrimination occurred. Otherwise, there could be no discrimination. So things like this were creeping up. That luckily the administration changed, and that was no longer an issue. But we've also been consulting with legislators. Our groups had over a dozen conversations in the last year with the New Mexico legislative body and committees of that body, and we helped to get some legislation passed on regulating deep fakes, and hope to continue working with them to pass some AI transparency bills in 2025. So through all of this work, we've talked to New Mexicans from, you know, students in our classes, to the New Mexico Supreme Court, to community groups around the state, just trying to raise issues about fairness in algorithms and AI. And so on the next slide, we are now feeling like we have an interdisciplinary foundation to begin to educate graduate students in this space. We have a proposal now. We hope that NSF will look at it favorably, but we're looking at various ways to fund underrepresented graduate students. We have a focus on African-American graduate students with this proposal that was led by four Black women faculty in computer science, sociology, education, and engineering, kind of spearheaded by our Asada Zarai, who's a sociology professor, and our vice president for equity and inclusion. And we really are trying to bring together sociology students and computer scientists to investigate questions of racial equity in artificial intelligence. And in doing this, one of the things that we realized is often when we talk about broadening participation, it appears to be, oh, let's offer you a seat at this table. And in this question of how to understand, you know, race and technology, we argue that Black women have been leading the way, that they were really, you know, quite, for good reason, very much aware, right? We were aware of the racial bias that was creeping up in algorithms. And so starting maybe on the right side there, Joy Boulamwini, right, whose own face was not recognized as human by facial recognition algorithms. Back in 2017, she wrote the Gender Shades article, which highlighted this, you know, very obvious form of bias that when you train in facial recognition algorithms, on the faces of the largely white and male technology workforce, it is unable to recognize dark skin and female faces even as human. That's an incredible, that was high impact work, but she's recently done some evaluation. You know, the particular tools that she pointed to in that article have been largely fixed, not entirely, but a lot of that bias has been addressed. But there are so many other tools. There's an explosion of tools, and they don't necessarily, they aren't any better necessarily than the original problems of bias that we saw, you know, 5, 6, 7 years ago. Ruha Benjamin, who wrote about what she calls the new Jim Code back in 2019, was, I think, a really prescient writer and continues to write about questions of AI and race. The Stochastic Parrots paper, written by Tanit Gambru and Emily Bender and others, highlighted the dangers that were forthcoming, right, that we now know about. This came out, I believe, in 2019 or 2020. And so this was, you know, these were people who could see what was coming, in part because of the perspective and the situation that they have in society. And so we really want to be able to train students to build on that tradition. On the next slide, I'll just highlight two of the areas where we are trying to build up research expertise among ourselves and our current and future students. One is in medical AI. This is from an op-ed that Professor Rankin from the law school and I have talking about medical AI should do no harm. And I think medicine is the place where AI maybe most obviously has the greatest promise. There's tremendous advances in, you know, AlphaFold, which is now approaching folding billions of proteins, right? Tremendous for drug discovery and new cancer therapies and vaccine design, all sorts of advances in patient care. And I think that the biggest threat is actually the lack of trust in these systems and the fact that often medical AI perpetuates what have been some racist medical practices of the past. So people are very familiar probably with things like the Henrietta Lacks cells, right, that were essentially stolen from her and her family and have resulted in enormous wealth and a lot of medical advances. Just recently, some justice for her family was achieved by law faculty who supported that case. But a lot of the Tuskegee experiments conducted in Tuskegee are another example, but a lot of these things are actually systematic and hidden. So for example, the algorithm that determines who gets a kidney transplant had a specific racial factor in there that was based on just racial ideas about muscle mass that had no basis in science, but resulted in thousands of African-Americans not making it onto kidney transplant lists. And that algorithm was changed. There's a great success story about how that equation was changed. And yet when you go to a large language model, what it does is it revives these recommendations from the past and actually perpetuates them into the future. And so things that have been fixed actually don't, that fix is ignored often in language models. And so our argument really is that trustworthy AI for medicine really requires that medicine itself be reformed and become more trustworthy. On the next slide, I will quickly highlight something that I have been somewhat obsessed with over the last 6 or 8 months. There was an article in The Lancet in which some scientists, some public health scientists, asked, at that time it was Stable Diffusion, to create an image of a Black doctor treating a white patient. And they wanted to counter sort of the narrative about who treats whom in global health. And when they did that, they generated over 300 images. Less than 3% of those images would actually show a Black doctor treating a white child. And so we tried to replicate that and found the same thing. We generated about 100 images. Only one of them actually generated a Black doctor treating a white child. The software would generate Black doctors treating Black children, white doctors treating white or Black children, but it just would not generate images of Black doctors treating white children, no matter how we tried to prompt it otherwise. We tied ourselves in knots trying to get it to cooperate and produce what we wanted. It would pretend that it had, right? It will produce captions and actually captions for these images that claim that it's a Black doctor treating a white child, but it won't actually generate this image, which is outside of the distribution of the data that it's been trained on. And so this next slide actually just shows this again has been somewhat remedied. This is the same prompt from a couple of weeks ago. First of all, the photorealism is far superior. there are actually images of a Black doctor treating white children, although interestingly, often the white children have afros or other sort of strange amalgamations of, you know, racial identity is blurred in an interesting way. I highlight this just because it is such an interesting case of why it is difficult to get the sorts of results you want out of this, you know, to envision particular things for the future, in contrast to what happened with Google Gemini, which was basically taken down, no longer creates images of human faces because they created images of, you know, Black German soldiers from World War II or women as founding fathers, right? They were accused of being too, quote, woke for doing that. So these are really difficult things to grapple with. I don't think there are easy answers, and that's why we want to fund graduate students to work on this. I will just end on the next slide just is a suggestion that as we're broadening participation, we should really think about how are we changing the face of the university and the way that students interact in universities. The image on the left shows what happens by default if you ask for a picture of a classroom. It is not a classroom that any of us probably teach in, and an attempt at coercing a picture of a classroom of the future. So I'll end on the last slide, which is what I thought was the most inspirational sort of message I've heard from John Powell, who's a civil rights lawyer at UC Berkeley. And he recounted the story of during the race to the moon, he was actually able to have a conversation with Kennedy. He went to one of the space stations to have that conversation, and walking in, he went and introduced himself and shook hands with the janitor. And he introduced himself, "I'm John Powell, I'm here to talk to Kennedy about getting Americans to the moon." And the janitor replied with his name. He said, "I'm the janitor here. I clean the floors in an effort to get America to the moon." And the point was that he felt like he was part of something bigger. He felt included. He felt like he could actually contribute to this amazing step forward for humanity. And that's what we need in AI. In fact, we all are and should be contributing our knowledge and our vision for the future to these systems. And that's really what I think broadening participation in AI should look like, that we should be including all of our voices and re-envisioning what the future might look like. So I will end there and turn this over to Amy to talk about cultural responsiveness.
All right. Thank you so much, Melanie. And then thank you for actually bringing it into UC system to end. So my name is Amy Eguchi. I'm the teaching professor at University of California, San Diego. I have multiple titles, but so my talk really focuses on students. And a student could be K-12, college, undergraduate, to teachers. But so the focus is cultural responsiveness and cultural relevancy. Next, please. So before I start talking about what it is to teach about AI and then teach with AI, that's the kind of term that we use in AI in education, I always want to check, you know, what's out in the society or the internet. So I asked the Microsoft, I used to use ChatGPT, but I asked this time Microsoft Copilot and see what actually comes out. So why should we teach children about AI? And then next slide, please. It gives us very decent, it just points out decent reason why, and it's really good, you know, future preparation, critical thinking. Oh, I forgot to highlight ethical understanding of AI, creativity, innovation, digital literacy, help them understand how it works and then potentially impacts, and then it actually talks about ethics. Fine. But there's something missing that's really important for us, which is, can you move to the next slide, please? AI is an issue of equity and access in schools, particularly because if you ban the use of AI in schools or not teaching about AI, it's actually exclude the students who don't have access to AI or that don't have parents who can actually teach them how to use AI, right? So the kind of work we have been doing is like, let's bring AI to the school so all students have some kind of experience opportunity to learn about and then also explore the AI tools in productive way. Next slide, please. And maybe a lot of people probably know about this work, AI for K-12 initiatives, five big ideas in AI. And I was part of this work. And then Irene was part of it. And then there are a lot of people. I saw Charlotte Duncan actually in the call too. It was a big collaboration to basically create a guidance. It's a guideline, it's not a standards guideline to help teachers to what to include in teaching AI. And then I think the slide's gonna be shared with everybody. So I'm not gonna go into the details because I just wanna make sure I have enough time to go through it. Next slide, please. The next slide, it shows you this video. And this video was actually used initially by Vicky Sedgwick, who is an early child educator. So let's watch this.
Alexa, play baby chair.
Baby chair. Explicit isn't included with Prime, but is available
Alexa,
with Amazon.
Alexa, play baby chair. Alexa, play baby chair.
Sure, baby, hold back. By Say Anything on Amazon Music.
Alexa! Alexa! Play baby shark!
Here's a sample of Baby Shark by Johnny Only on Amazon Music.
Alexa!
Okay. Alexa, play Baby Shark.
Baby Shark by Pink Floyd, starting now on Amazon Music.
So it's cute, it's funny, she's ecstatic, she has now Baby Shark playing. But I mean, when you use this with younger students, you know, this is to prompt, okay, this is how AI works, and then AI understands you, but here's an issue. AI is excluding some population of people, right? Toddlers are people, and then they can't use AI because their talk is not a quote-unquote American standard. So then we can talk about why this is happening, and then some of them actually already touched upon, I think, part of Enrico's slides, but AI has issues, and then one of the issues. The AI was Apple's Apple Watch that I have one. Blood oxygen sensor doesn't work with darker skin. Might be already fixed, I don't know. But so that was actually in the news. And then the other one is Airbnb. I haven't seen it in the US, but like I have seen that in Asian countries. So you actually use your face to confirm your reservation, and it didn't work with South Asian women. So she needed to use her husband, who is white guy, to activate her reservation. Another one, this is also talking about Black women. I think it was a woman who actually had an interview at NPR last year. The speech recognition technology doesn't understand some of the Black community's speech. Again, it's not a mainstream English. I have accents, but I can use all those AI tools, but not Black people. Why is it? Because there's the kind of data the company is using is not including enough data from the Black community. So those are the equity issues. And then we need to talk about that with students as well when you teach about AI and then point that out why this is happening and then and then talk about importance of broadening the participation. But next slide shows some of the tools that we can use. That's an AI tool. A teacher boom has seen that Eileen was talking about is also a Google tool. And there is a way to actually fake the data in the way that doesn't actually give you the right result after training the model. Quick draw is, I don't know if you have played with quick draw. There's a link to the quick draw on the slide. If you can play with it later, that would be fantastic. But it actually asks you to draw different images. It gives you the prompt and then asks you to draw different images. And it's kind of fun. It's very interesting. AI is getting smarter, exciting, but here's an issue. And I just pull out some of the images that I thought could be an issue. One is the I have to use the word because then otherwise people won't know, flip-flops. When you hear flip-flops, most of you probably write the flip-flops, right? But flip-flops is such an American-centric term for this thing. Because as you probably know, like England and also Australia, it's thong. Japanese culture, it's dori. It could be sandal. And whoever created this tool decided to use the term flip-flops, thinking that's the normal term for everybody to understand, right? So there is an exclusion of some cultures in this tool itself too. For example, snowflakes. If you have grown up in African countries and then moving to the US and living in San Diego, you have never seen the snow. You have no idea what this looks like. Maybe because a lot of schools are now cutting science. That's another issue. The mailbox doesn't look that in Japanese culture. I'm Japanese, so I can talk about Japanese culture. If you are like, I also spent like 20 years in my life living in New York City. Some of the kids might not know how burn looks, or what snorkel is, and you know, goes on and on and on. I can't remember what this one is. Oh, dishwasher is the one in the middle. There are people who don't even own a dishwasher. Passport is another, the little book that's passport. I mean, why do you expect everybody to have a passport? Maybe some kids don't have a passport. They have never seen a passport, right? So there is a lot of exclusion happening. Also, like for example, my reaction to this was like, I'm a second generation atomic bomb survivor. I was so afraid of planes. It actually didn't matter when I was little. I was so afraid of planes because I was growing up hearing about it. Oops, 10 minutes. Yes. So anyway, so there's a very, very important thing that you have to pay attention to. And then it's going to be really quick. Next slide, please. When we teach kids, we really have to think about who they are, right? Who's in the class and what they're familiar with, what they're interested in, what kind of experience they have growing up. If you don't pay attention to that, your lesson will be not culturally relevant or culturally responsive. And then also the next slide. Also, when you discuss AI, you have to talk about, you know, this is social impact part. Who participated in creating an AI? Who benefited from? Who was harmed by it? Those are the very important discussions that you have to have with students. And then last work that this is really focusing on teacher education programs. Those are the things that we want teacher education programs to actually integrate into their programs so that we train the teachers who can actually teach culturally relevant AI education, AI literacy lessons. And I'm gonna, sorry, a little bit over, I'm gonna send it back to Enrico.
Thank you so much, Amy, and thank you to all the speakers. Of course, we could actually talk about all these topics for hours, because these are difficult topics, difficult conversation, but I hope that at least from this presentation, you get a sense about possible direction that have been explored and some of the challenges that we have to face. So I think we have 5 minutes left, so I would really like to leave it up for any type of questions. And in the meantime, I would really like to just say thank you to all of you for being attendance, and thank you to actually all the speakers for dedicating some of their time to this presentation.
And we do have a couple of questions that have come through the chat or the Q&A. And I have a couple for Tom. And those are your AI classes online or in person, as well as are those courses, course offerings only available if you apply to the college, or are they individual online courses that someone could enroll
in? Very good questions. You do have to apply to the college, but that's easy. Anyone gets admitted. It's a $15 registration fee to register to the college. So the first class, the AIM 100 is totally online. The Python class, I think we have online offerings for that. The rest of them, what we do is we call it high flex. So with the high flex, it's those that want to come into the classroom, come to the classroom. Those that want to attend it remotely, can attend it remotely. It's like live online. You still have to attend the session, but you can do it remotely. So that's how we do the classes there.
Thank you, Tom. And I know that there was some interest in hearing a little bit more about Irene's professional development program as well in the chat. And she did go ahead and answer that info in there. So that's available. But Irene, I didn't know if you wanted to speak to that a little bit.
I guess I just wanted to see if I answered Gabriel's question sufficiently, if he had any follow-ups.
I think you gave a very thorough answer. While I'm waiting to see if there was any, or if it was fully answered. I guess Gabriel is answering where, or asking where is the answer. So,
yeah, it looks like the answer was just sent to hosts and panelists. So if you'd like to kind of summarize what you said there, and then I'll copy and paste it back over. So
thank
it goes
you.
To everyone, of course.
Thank you. So to recap, Gabriel asked, or he would like to hear more about the teacher training and who is imagined to teach these courses. In particular, there are significant equity gaps in CS and math instructors throughout the United States, especially those serving minoritized communities. So I responded, great question. We purposefully recruited teachers of color and those serving students of color to join our professional development, and the students and recruited students of color to attend our summer camps that double as the teacher's practicum experience. And then I went on to say, I didn't get to talk through this portion of the slide, but our everyday AI program makes extra efforts to reach and invite teachers of color to apply. It is important to seek teachers who represent the students they teach. Research has shown that having a teacher of the same race, ethnicity can have positive impacts on a student's attitudes, motivation, and achievement. And teachers of color may have more positive expectations for students of color's achievement than non-minority teachers. And I cited some research to that effect.
And if I may, I would like to just stress the fact that Irene talked about the expansion of the Everyday AI program in New Mexico. And one of the emphasis that we placed in this expansion is to serve rural communities across the state. And we have received an amazing response from teachers across the state, especially coming from very underserved communities.
And thank you both so much for that answer. The final thing that I saw coming through the chat was kind of a shout out to LaTanya Sweeney's work. So if you all want to check that out as well, and I will turn it back over to Sarah Yu for wrap up.
I saw Melanie unmute though, so if you have anything to plus one the LaTanya Sweeney love, definitely we're going to leave some time for that.
Thank you. I will do that. I actually posted also accidentally to the hosts rather than to everyone that yes, LaTanya Sweeney, I would identify as the GOAT. Like her work is just absolutely seminal. And, you know, back in, 20 years ago, more than that, perhaps, she was talking about these issues when no one else was. So absolutely.
All right. Well, with that, we're going to go ahead and wrap up our session here today. Thank you all so much. For those, definitely share your gratitude in the chat for this wonderful panel. I wish you could hear the raucous applause, even virtually. And for those of you who are wishing that we could continue this conversation, please do know that we are planning to continue this conversation live in Kansas City, Missouri, at the NCWIT Summit this year, happening May 20th through the 22nd. If you'd like more information about that, definitely reach out to our team. The theme of the summit is actually the future of tech, so a lot of good conversation happening around AI there. And again, of course, fill out the evaluation form if you haven't already done so, and be in touch with us if there's any ways that NCWIT can support the systemic change work at your institutions. Thank you all so much and have a wonderful day.
Thanks, everyone.